One, two, three.
Hello, welcome to Rock the Cash Bar. I'm Ben Mowbray.
And I'm Diane Gallagher.
Every week we pick one song and do a deep dive into the lyrics and explain the different ways they've been interpreted.
We will also discuss how the song connected to us on a personal level, focusing on all the embarrassing details.
Glad to have you here. Enjoy the show. Hey, everybody. Welcome to the Cash Bar. Diane, how you doing?
Good. How are you?
I'm recovering. Last week was rough. Last week broke me. We ended up doing the 15 or 20 saddest songs ever. And I still think I'm recovering. Like, I was a little bit drunk by the end of that episode.
Yeah,
it was
too.
Only noon. I had to go take a nap, a tearful sobbing into my pillow nap. Trigger warnings for the family of John Denver. I guess John Lennon too. But it was weird. It was therapeutic. It was a good one. I felt like I needed it. I'm excited about this week's episode because it's going to be a palate cleanser for that. Fun stuff today. I was talking to our guest a couple of weeks ago about doing this episode, and she said, I just can't wait to come on and just squee. And I can't wait to have her on and just squee. I'm excited to have this guest on. She is a multi-hyphenate. She's a comedian. She's a performance artist. She's a witch. She's a sex witch. She's a tarot card reader. She's also, and this is very sweet, a cuddle therapist. She's the oddest duck on the pond, ladies and gentlemen, Miss Britt Vasicek. Britt, how are you?
Welcome.
Hi, I feel so delightfully odd.
I'm sorry to describe you that way, but you do so many things and so many of them are off the beaten path. Like, it's hard not to introduce you that way. I certainly didn't mean to be insulting in any way. I mean, all of
that. No, I love it. I love it.
It makes my resume look so fucking lame. I used to be way worse, but now I'm just a mom. And used to be a lot of stuff. Enjoy your 20s, man. Get it all in.
You're having a glass of wine at 7 o'clock on a Wednesday and feeling bad about it.
I'll feel bad about it in the morning.
Yeah. I mean, being a mom is hard.
Yeah, especially since I started
kombucha.
Oh yeah, I started. I didn't become a mom till way late. I was one of those. I don't want to get married. I don't want to have kids. And then the same guy made me do both, like in my late 30s. So it's a little rougher when you do it that way.
It's good when you can get the same guy to do it for you, though. That's a blessing.
Yeah.
We're doing a song today called "Love Affair" by UMI. And I'm glad Diane told me that it's pronounced UMI because it's spelled capital U, capital M, capital I. And I definitely would have old guyed it. Like, okay, we're here to talk about UMI.
I think I said that last week, actually.
All right. This is really interesting because like Diane and I are old and we're attracted to music that's even older than us. So this is by far the freshest jam that we've had on this podcast. And it's what, 2 or 3 years old? When did this come out?
When did it come out?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know I was going to be quizzed on that.
No, sorry, I'm not quizzing.
Don't worry about it.
When did you become aware of it? How did you find it? Because this is the other thing that's like this is YouTube generation music, and I am not YouTube generation.
Yeah, I will say that I'm kind of lame when it comes to music, so I know that I discovered UMI late. Like, I was not in the first wave of UMI fans, but kind of near the end of the pandemic, I was living with my ex-girlfriend and she watches YouTube like all the fucking time, like instead of television, which is not my scene at all. Right. But she was on a YouTube rabbit hole watching music videos, and we landed on UMI doing a live performance of her album Introspection. And I just like fell in love with her, and I fell in love with her music. And this is the song that like I'm singing when I'm in a good mood, like it gets stuck in my head like crazy. She has a bunch of different versions of it. I love this song in particular.
It was the video that got me. Have you seen the video of it? Or have you seen the different versions of it? But it's like, it's wild. It's just wild.
I like it.
Yeah, I didn't see the video until I showed it to someone. I was showing them the song and I was like, wait a second.
Yeah.
What is going on here?
This is not what I was picturing when I was hearing this song.
Exactly. Yeah, it definitely changed the vibe.
Yeah.
It's one of those, because I've never experienced the song without the video, so they're forever going to be married in my head. And I think it's a perfect blend. Like it's magical what the video does to the song and what the song does to the video. It's really something else. Go look it up. Love Affair by UMI UMI on YouTube. Watch it. You've got 5 seconds. Then we're going into the lyrics. Watch the video. Isn't it incredible? Here we go. All right, so this is going to be strange. I'm a 41-year-old white guy reading lyrics by a teenaged African-American woman. So here we go.
You and I, baby. Maybe we can ride away, baby. And I just want to get inside, baby. But I don't want to wait forever. Scared that I can be you better than her.
You and I, baby, maybe we can take a ride, baby. And I just want to get inside, baby. The car. She wants to get inside the car. Get your mind out of the gutters. But I don't want to wait forever. Scared that I can't treat you better than her. That line kind of surprised me, because I'm not used to women expressing feelings of inadequacy in that direction. Do you know what, like that kind of struck me by surprise.
Haven't you heard Jolene?
Yes, I have. I don't know why, but it's probably just ignorance. But it surprises me to think that women would have that fear, like that I can't treat you better than her, because I don't think that's really going on in it's certainly not going on in my head when I'm with a new lady, you know. So like you're just not thinking about it. It's just not the way that men work. Like it just seems like, I don't mean to, I'm not saying that she's being false. I'm just saying that it surprises me. It surprises dumb me. It's not.
I think women definitely have the same insecurities that men do.
Mm-hmm. I think it's really endearing. I mean, you know, not to zoom out to the whole song, but I think I do kind of like songs about like women being the other woman. Like Lana Del Rey has a song where she mentions that. Rihanna has a song about being unfaithful. And then Jolene also is one of those songs, which, you know, and these attitudes really are kind of set apart of like, you know, what it feels like to kind of be insecure as a woman, comparing yourself to other women, which is something that we are kind of doing all the time. But also it's sweet to hear like a woman wanting to treat a guy well. Like you don't get a lot of that of like, you hear a lot of songs about men wanting to love women, but like for a woman to be like, I want to love you. Like it just makes my queer little heart like so happy.
For sure. Yeah. Because so many songs now, it's just like gold digger women. Like what can you do for me? And I love a giver. Like I'm a giver, and I like hearing about women who are a little insecure and just want to be the lover and like be the aggressor. And you know, I think it's sweet. And there's way more women like that than you hear in music.
Mm-hmm. For sure. I always wonder, like how do you, when she says scared that I can't treat you better than her, what does she mean non-sex division? Do you know what I mean? Like, is she is my home nicer? Like, is it like, cause that's the kind of thing that I worry about at my age. Just like, I don't have the money to give you the life that you want. Like that's kind of where like my insecurities and inadequacies come from. Like, I wonder what, and again, non-sex division, what a young woman means when she said scared that I can't treat you better than her. Like,
well, there's also, I mean, if you think about it in the context of an affair, it's like in order for him to ever leave his woman, there would have to be something about the treatment that he's getting elsewhere in order for that to happen.
Right. I didn't read anything in this about it being an affair. Is it an affair in your head? Because songs are, I mean, they mean different things to different people. There's no wrong answers.
I mean, it's kind of a vibe. It has kind of like, you know, because it says love affair a lot.
It says love affair, and the scared I can't treat you better than her. I mean, that's enough for me to think it is.
Yeah. And I guess I didn't, okay, maybe I'm just being extra dumb, because obviously the title of the song is love affair. But I just took that as like love affair means two things. Like love affair doesn't necessarily mean that there's any cheating going on. Like
right.
You can have a love affair with two people who aren't committed to anybody else. That was the, right. that was the way I was taking it. Like this is the begin. I took it as her being sort of full of doubt about her own feelings, and then wondering if he was full of the same doubt. Like that sort of thing that new couples do. We're just like, do you love me as much as I love you? Like it, that kind of dance. Are you as committed to this as I want you to be, or as I right. want you to be? Maybe it's
open for interpretation. Maybe it can be seen as both, mm-hmm. and maybe she is okay with it being seen as both.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, let's ask her.
Let's do it. Get her on the phone.
I'll tweet her. So when I'm gonna know what to feel inside, baby,
maybe it's just all in my head. So don't overthink this love, maybe it's just a grudge, baby. So when am I gonna know how to feel, what to feel inside, baby? Maybe it's just all in my head. So don't overthink, this is love, maybe it's just a crush. That's what I'm talking about. Like, it seems like all of her squishy feelings, they're not, it doesn't feel like it's coming from any kind of romantic conflict. Like, it just sounds like it's coming from like she's just really excited by this dude and doesn't know if he feels the same way.
Yeah.
Yeah, it is
always
so squishy.
The most fun.
When right, I was...
Go ahead, Britt.
Kind of really getting into this song. Oh, go ahead. When I was really getting into the song, I had a crush on someone and it would get stuck in my head a lot. Like it was just such a cute little like thing of like, you know, I don't really like each other yet. And I don't even know if we're going to date, but it is that those early feelings of like, what is this, you know, like when you have a crush, of like, you know, just feeling kind of uncertain and kind of excited, and no matter where it goes, it's like fun to be interacting with someone that you have a crush on.
Yeah
and it's like I'm either going to go buy a ring or I'm going to go throw myself off a bridge. Like it's going to be wow, an extreme. There's not going to be a mature reaction to this in either direction.
I think it's really cute. Before we started, Ben was like, part of it feels like I'm reading the diary of a 13-year-old girl, which is definitely could have been my diary at 13. Yeah. Like, am I in love? Is this just a crush? Are you loving me?
Oh, I wrote exactly these sorts of things when I was 14 or 15. For sure I did.
I want to hear you sing it.
Baby, is this your love affair? Your love affair. I have a terrible voice.
Yeah.
I hope what I feel is enough. Maybe this is just lust. Baby, is this your love affair? Your love affair. Yeah. I really like this because the words are raw, and it is like that's a question that I think a lot of couples, or every couple, probably ask themselves at some point. Like, is this just the way you do it? Like, is this just who you are? Like, is everything that I'm having a problem with? Like, is it, I mean, she just comes right out and says it. Like, is it all in my head, or is this just the way that you like to do it?
Yeah. Like, am I being played?
Yep.
Yeah.
Every woman's been there.
Because mm-hmm. sometimes I'm attracted to someone purely sexually. Like, is it just lust? And then I actually get to know them and I'm like, you know, I'm a Virgo. So I'm like, this person is not practical to like actually be in a relationship with. And that doesn't make flirting with them less fun or like, mm-hmm. you know, being in that space with them less fun, but it's just like, okay, I can kind of take this off the table for that.
It's like the poor guy doesn't know that the hand's already been dealt. I let him think he's still in the game for a good 6-8 months.
Oh, you shouldn't go that long. That's not nice.
Hey, if you go 6 to 8 months flirting with someone without ever asking them what kind of relationship they want, then that's on you.
For sure.
Yeah, I don't think I've ever gone 6 or 8 months. No, that's not a thing. I do.
I think I've gone more than 3 days. Like, where are we going? What's going on here?
I don't even know. I've been out of the game for so long. I don't even know what my order of operations is. Like, I have no idea. I don't know what the habit is. technology's changed it. It's all different now. It's not the way it was. I don't know how to do it. I want to know. I want to know how to feel, what to feel, what's right. I never know, because when it gets real, I just run away and hide from you. Guilty. I'm guilty.
Such a dude thing. I'm really surprised to hear this from a girl, because that is such a dude thing. Like, when they catch feelings, they're like, I don't know what the fuck this is. Mommy didn't train me for this. And then they're out.
Yeah, okay. That's absolutely true. I've done it both ways. I've done it because, like, the feelings are too deep and I'm scared of them. And then I've done it the other way. It was just like, everything I said to you was a lie. I don't feel that way at all. Mm-hmm. Like, it was, but not okay. Yeah, in the moment. When you look like, you guys don't understand, because you're in like the top 1% of attractive people, okay? I'm in the bottom 50. We got to work harder.
Thank you.
I can honestly say, and this is why, I mean, I love UMI. She's an amazing lyricist. And I really resonate with those lyrics, because I have a pattern of when I get deep, like when I'm starting to feel deeply for someone, I'm like, okay, better peace out. Which, you know, you can read books about it. It's called Avoid an Attachment, and I'm working on it. So everybody's doing their best. But I do that all the time.
Do you do that to protect yourself, or do you do that to protect them?
Good question.
I think I do it to avoid having any amount of pleasure or intimacy whatsoever. I don't think anyone gets protected by that reaction. I think it punishes everyone.
That surprises me, because so much of what you do is about intimacy. Like, that's a really, that really surprises me to hear you say that you avoid it. Like, you seem to be like the kind of person who's always open for intimacy.
Well, that's the thing, is I have such a capacity to be vulnerable that I don't really trust everyone with that.
I'm wondering if you feel comfortable giving, but your gate is like, you know.
Yeah, I definitely get in my head about what, like I was saying before, about someone not being quote unquote practical and like for a future. I'm always thinking like 300 steps ahead in my life. So like, if we have one conversation where I can tell that, like, okay, that one thing just made me feel like if I were to ever have a deep conversation with you about my feelings, like it wouldn't go well, you know? Like, yeah. You know how Seinfeld is just a show about like one thing being wrong with people, and like, yeah, he ditches them. That's how.
Yeah. I've been guilty of that.
Like, all of a sudden is like my.
Sorry, I think we have a delay. I was just gonna say I'm guilty of that. Like, things will be go so great. I mean, obviously I've been with the same guy for 16 years. So I'm reminiscing on the past, but, they do just like one thing that you're like, oh, we're done. No, we're done here.
Yep. Being on the other side of that, when you tell a joke or you take the wrong angle or something like that, and you can see like the light go out of their eyes or the smile start to fade, and you're just like, I'm never getting back, am I? Never getting back on that level.
That's funny. I was always such the opposite. I was such a lover of love, and I was boy crazy. And I think it, because I experienced so much rejection. We talked about this last week, so much rejection in my like younger teen years. And I just wanted to love so hard that whenever like someone was finally open to it, and I wanted to open up their rib cage, get inside and wrap myself around their heart. Like, oh, we're doing this hard. We're going hard. That was my approach.
I mean, that's pretty in line with the music video. So it's a similar vibe.
Yeah.
The video was fantastic. I can't wait. Let's finish up the lyrics and then get into that video.
Okay.
Where were we?
No, I don't even know.
Yeah, when it gets real, I just want to run away and hide from you. Ooh. So when am I going to know what to feel inside, baby? Maybe it's all in my head. So, and then it's the chorus. But then it gets to the bridge of the song. And the bridge is usually where the lyricist and the songwriter like to like beat you over the head with what they're talking about. And I think she does it here. And I just want a good time. But am I wrong for that? No. Am I wrong for that? No. Yeah. And it's not the right time, but what's wrong in that? Oh, am I wrong for that? No. So, and then into the chorus again. So I do think, and maybe this is me being an old man, looking at a younger person trying to write down their thoughts. Like, I wonder if this is just somebody like exploring their sexuality and learning about themselves, learning what's fun, learning what they like, and then feeling a little bit of shame and regret as they learn those lessons along the way. Do you know what I mean? Like, and then asking themselves, like, was what I did really wrong? Like, that's what I'm supposed to be out here doing, isn't it? Yes, no, maybe, I don't know.
Yeah. I feel like she's being very present.
Yeah, I think, and she's keeping a good eye on herself.
I mean, I love the idea that she's just, yeah, being present for her reaction. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I guess I just project affairs on the everything, but.
Yeah. I think it's strange how lines change from gender to gender. Like, if a man said something like, and I just want a good time, but am I wrong for that? The answer is probably like, well, yeah, you are. But when it's coming from a lady, it's like, no, you go out and you go have yourself a good time.
Oh, yeah. Ladies are always allowed and respected for, like, you know, being a feminist and being wild. Where dudes just like, you need to commit. You need to not play with this girl's feelings. Like, it's a total double standard.
Yeah, but I think it's just because men get so rowdy about it. It's like, just calm the fuck down, asshole. It's like, you can't. I think I think it was you that told me this, Diane, many, many years ago. We were talking about one night stands, and he said, well, sometimes you just need to validate yourself. And I was like, yeah, I guess that is true. That is true. You just need to do it just to feel like, to feel desired or to feel wanted. Yeah. And there's no shame in that, for sure. Although people will make you feel it.
Yeah. Oh, fucking. Oh, yeah. Fuck those people. Yeah.
Yeah. Like, literally, fuck them. Have a one night stand with them. Show them who's boss.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. And send them out without letting them put their pants back on. Like, here, throw it into the hallway. There you go. You're done.
Ben, I don't remember telling you that. Was I trying to convince you to go have a one night stand, or was I talking about one of my own?
No, you were talking about one of your own. You never tried to convince me to have a one night stand.
Okay.
I'd remember that.
I'm not saying with me. I was telling you to go get some out there.
No, it wasn't. It was you were, I can't remember anymore.
Don't drop a name.
I don't know. I'm not dropping any names. We keep the names out of this podcast.
Drop the name.
There was no name. I don't remember specifically. I think we were just talking about sex in general.
All right.
Good. I was probably trying to impress you with my elaborate knowledge of the whole affair. Here's how it works, Diane. I was 23-year-old me trying to tell 27-year-old you what's up.
It's like, I've slept with so more people than you. What are you going to try to teach me right now?
The video to this song is, I wrote like a brief synopsis of it because it's just so much fun to watch. The first scene in the video is like, it's like a weird meat cleaver coming down onto some kind of rubber synthetic fabric, and you just don't know what's going on. It looks like it's taking place in some kind of mysterious shop that you might buy a gremlin in or something like that. And then the next shot.
Did we watch two different videos?
there's like an 8-second like preamble before they get into the coffee shop, and that's what this is. And then there's a guy working on the rubber synthetic on a sewing machine, and then you see like the main character, who I guess we don't know it's UMI yet, but she just kind of presses it up to her face, and then the next shot we see is her in her job at the coffee shop, and she's just kind of smiling, and she's being the good, friendly, pretty barista. Okay. And she's helping people in the coffee shop, and then a handsome fellow that she obviously has a crush on comes up, and they have an exchange as she's singing the song. She hands him his cappuccino and he walks away, and then she looks up all dreamy like into a thought bubble that's going, it's like a pink thought bubble, and he's in it, he's smiling, looking down at her and smiling, they're having a good conversation, she's beaming up at it, and then it cuts to her coworker, and she can see the thought bubble, like she can see the fantasy that's going on. It's very real world, like you can tell. It's just like she's kind of disturbed, like what kind of superpowers does my barista friend have? And then a guy comes up and puts a gun on the counter and a note with dollar signs on it. So he's robbing the place. And that's when UMI just loses her shit. Like the whole thing just turns red, and she kicks the guy in the face. And then the fantasy resets itself and she hits him over the head with a vase, and it resets itself again. And she comes up behind him and does that snap in the neck, like the American ninja thing that we all want to try, don't you? Don't you want to, just come up behind somebody and grab him by the chin and the top of the head and just see if you can do the big actual neck snapping thing. So it's clear that she's in some kind of like ragey panic, and it's also appears to be going on in some kind of world that exists between reality and fantasy land. But then the guy that she was flirting with kind of comes in, and it's obviously very real. Like, he comes and tackles the guy, and water flies everywhere, and he kind of shoves him out of the coffee shop. And that's the end of her workday. She gets on the subway and she goes home to her apartment. She opens the door to her apartment and locks about 19 deadbolts. So clearly there's massive threats to Umi in the outside world. And then she starts to settle in. Like, she's taking off her clothes, putting on the, like, she's just a lady settling in for the evening. But her animated pet cat comes out of her pile of laundry and then starts like watching her. And then she takes off like the rubber synthetic thing. And you realize, like, she literally has to put on a human suit over her fully animated self just to go out into the world and feel normal, which I thought was just a fascinating metaphor for the video and probably for what women have to do with makeup and hair and everything altogether. It's just like, I literally have to press myself into human form to go out and deal with you fuckers. Is that about right?
Well, I kind of saw it as, you know, within the context of the song, like how she's, I mean, first of all, people get shamed for how much they love anime a lot in our culture, right? And we can tell that Umi is an anime fan, and that's okay.
I don't know enough, like, about anime life, to shame anybody for it. I feel bad about that.
Yeah. So she like has like this kind of excited, you know, joyful, very pure of heart, like identity under her human skin. But like, when you're thinking about when you have a crush on someone, you're really excited, but you don't want to be too excited because you don't want to, like, you know, blow up your spot or seem like you're crazy or be too attached if they're not interested. You know what I mean? So I just saw it as her having, like, I think it's kind of like what we do when we're weird people and like, we don't really fit in or have like a thing in the world. And so we're like, okay, I guess I'll just be a fucking barista and like go be boring or whatever. And that's also what you're seeing when she has like this imaginary, you know, fight with this guy. Is like, she's actually, you know, a really adventurous kind of like quirky girl, but in real life, she can't like be her cartoon self. Like, she can't actually fight back.
Right. I really just like the idea of like, she's a cartoon in a human suit. Like, that's the way I feel pretty much all the time. I have to put on my human suit. The cartoon days are over. So Britt, you relate to that, the cartoon in a human suit? Do you feel that way sometimes? I feel like with all the weird hats and things that you put on, because you live your life pretty publicly online and you do a lot of different things that probably get you a lot of like, I would imagine that there are people that approach you thinking that like they want you to be this one thing when you're so many other things. Like,
yeah, I get that cartoon in a human suit feeling whenever I have to get a day job or like whenever I'm at the grocery store or I'm like at a party with a bunch of people that have like regular incomes and people are like, oh yeah, what do you do? And I have to explain that my life is not like in this timeline or in this reality or, you know, valid or viable. It is, there's one part where it's like, oh, you know, people are really excited and interested, but then there's also the part that like they just don't understand what's going on. Like, I'm a fucking witch, dude. Like, I'm on another level.
I don't understand what's going on. I understand the witch thing a little bit. I've got two very close friends who are very witchy. I wanted to ask you about cuddle therapy for two reasons. One, that seems really, really strange. I don't mean to be judgmental, but it does seem strange. And then the second part of me is just like, I really wish that didn't seem so strange because that probably seems pretty nice. how does it even work? Like, I don't know. I read an article about you in the Houston Press saying that you were a cuddle therapist. They talked a little bit about what that is. The only thing that I took away from it is that you'll cuddle someone who needs a cuddle.
Yeah, I mean, it's just like, you know, you pay hourly and some people need to be held. Yeah. Most people need to be held, actually. Mm-hmm. You know, it releases a lot of positive chemicals in your brain. And we live in a society, I mean, especially after quarantine, and that's when I started doing it. There are a lot of people that are really touch starved. Mm-hmm. But we also live in a society that's like very anti-touch, very anti-community. You know, we have weird boundaries around like romance and sex where you can't really hold your friends in the way that I think humans ought to be able to hold each other. And so I just professionally fill that gap.
Mm-hmm. Well, to add to that, I'm going to say there's a lot of people, especially from the generation that I'm from, that maybe their parents stopped holding them at a certain age. And, you know, like once you, you know, when you're younger, they do it a lot. And then you hit your teenage years when you fucking need it more. And then that's when they're wanting you to be more adult and they stop. And I think that craving gets really big. And then you're also becoming a teenager where, I mean, there's cuddling as a teenager, but then you're just so hyper-focused on what is sex? How am I doing that? You know, yeah. And like, I think as an adult, when you really do crave that touch and that just that tenderness and that holding.
Yeah. I do. It's kind of surprising to me, like how much that is what I crave even more than sex. Yep. Like, I don't know how to put it other than that. Like, I find the first time that I'm with a new person to be stressful to the point where I'll run away from it. You know, like the song says, you know, it might not be that I've caught the feeling so much as it's just like, it's just, I don't know. Like, it's hard for me to admit in public because I'm a man and I'm supposed to be telling you how awesome I am. Well, I'm stressful. Like, it stresses me out. Like, is she going to enjoy it? Am I too skinny for her? Do I smell bad? Is she looking at my bald spot or my teeth stain? Like, I just tie myself up in a knot about the whole thing. And of course, am I going to be good enough? Am I going to satisfy her? Am I going to be enough for her? Like, it really, really scares me to death, you know, to the point where like, yeah, like there's definitely, especially on like night one with somebody new, I'd be like, can we just leave the sex out of it? It would really be easier for me if we just, could we just spoon for a night and see how it goes tomorrow?
Because I think it's way more honest when you're like, can you show me first night that you can do intimacy? Because that's what I'm going to end up wanting the most in the end.
It's not a thing that I like about myself, but it is definitely a thing that I really do experience. Like, I'm scared to death.
Yeah, I think for men especially, but not just men.
Oh no, she's probably
to cross that threshold in order to receive love or receive.
Britt, start over. Right when you said not just men, you froze a little bit. So start over.
Oh, okay. We are all kind of socialized to believe that sex is a barrier to receiving those things like touch and care and intimacy. And so a lot of our relationships reflect that. And I think that's why, you know, I'm a very sex positive person. A lot of my art is about sex positivity, but I think that we're kind of fucking it up with hookup culture. And the way that we have this narrative around what sex is, because that's not really how, you know, humans are supposed to work. I think it's kind of capitalist propaganda. It's by denying ourselves authentic sexual expression, we create those moments of anxiety around sex. And it's not just men, you know, women have stuff around that with consent too. And so that's, I think a lot of that trauma that lives outside of our body about what we're allowed to say, how we're not good enough, how we're allowed to connect and what that's supposed to look like. It's really supposed to be more unique to the individual. And that stuff does live in our body. So things like yoga, massage, cuddling. I don't know if you've heard of EFT tapping. Mm-hmm. Like, there are a lot of ways that you can unlock all of the things that are hiding in your body so that you can release that stress and you can come back to your sexuality from your perspective rather than a perspective that's been fed to you by the media.
What is EFT tapping?
It's cool.
Yeah, it's like there's these points on your body that you can tap, and you can say affirmations while you do it. Like, different points on your body have different things that they do, and it's a way to kind of work through trauma or anxiety. I use it a lot when I can feel a panic attack coming on, and people will make fun of me because I'm over here like banging my forehead mm-hmm. with my fingers. It kind of looks funny, but I'm, you know, just trying to reduce the, you know, outcome of me actually having a panic attack in this bar right now by tapping my forehead.
Yeah. You're teaching it to children now, which is really good because my son's on the spectrum and, you know, I think he's going to have some anxiety because I have anxiety. And like, what I love is that, you know, they're teaching it to kids now to kind of calm their emotions when he gets like really overwhelmed. It's really cool. It's really helpful. It looks like something that, like, if you were a skeptic, you'd be like, well, that's not working, but it works. It's great.
I can see it. Like I stand on one foot and kind of do like a very mild yoga pose behind the bar when I'm in panic mode. Like I'm just take a second to myself, like, what's going on there? Like, hey man, do you think you could hurry up? No, I'm gonna throw a crane kick.
I'm gonna flamingo.
Don't talk to me until I've had my flamingo.
Yeah.
This garden gnome needs a break. Taking some mental time off, by God.
Yeah, if you haven't tried it, Google it. Or if you email me, I'll send you. I have a couple of friends that facilitate some workshops and I can send you their way.
But it's just like, it's basically at its root, it's just temple tapping or trying to, it's like the, you know, like if you have a headache, you rub the nerve between your thumb and your finger. Like, is it based on that? Like the acupuncture idea that there are places you can touch yourself or someone can touch you that's going to activate certain centers of your brain? Is that what it is? Or am I way off on?
I mean, it's similar. It's like, there's a point under your lip right here, like where your chin and your lip have that little crevice, and then above your under your nose, above your lip, your temples, your forehead, your rib cage as well, the top of your head.
Does it have to do with your nervous system? Like, you know, because that's just everywhere.
Uh-huh. Yeah, it's based on ventral vagal theory. So your vagus nerve is like what it's supposedly relaxing when you're doing that.
That's right. That's right.
Britt, could you take us through, like, what is a typical cuddle therapy session? Like, I doubt that anyone is typical, but like how do you, what is that?
What is cuddle? yeah, so.
Put me in the corner of the bathroom and never touched me again.
Well, I get some security information up front, as well as a deposit when I book the session. Then I show up and we kind of spend 5 minutes talking about boundaries. Like, is there a place you don't want me to touch? Blah, blah, blah. You know, are there things that you want during this session? And then it's kind of, I don't know how kinky y'all are, but it's kind of like when you're doing a kink scene with someone, you like, you know, talk about it first, make sure that nothing changes during the cuddle session. So like we get everything out of the way up front and just talk about how it's going to go for them, what exactly they need. Some people want their head scratched or they want to be spooned. A lot of dudes want to be spooned. And I'm here to tell you, I will fucking spoon a dude. Okay. I'm a perfect big spoon.
I just want to interrupt and say, I'm so short. I'm always laughing. Like if I spoon a dude, I'm like, if you stand up, I would look like your backpack right now.
Yeah. Some people call it backpacking. Like, can you backpack me? You know, it's like, I mean, sometimes the dudes are smaller than me, but sometimes they are bigger than me and it is hilarious, but it's nice. And then, you know, we can watch TV, we can put on music. We can play video games if you want. Some people like to talk the whole time. That's cool too. Because I am a great listener, you know, and it is definitely emotionally exhausting. It's like very energetic work. You have to be on, you know, generally they're about an hour and a half. Ask, how is this? And then, and then I leave.
I imagine it's like, I think of like a masseuse giving a massage, like that's got to be physically exhausting. And then they're like, okay, make you feel better. We good. You know,
I can't imagine like 90 minutes of being emotionally available to a stranger is like, I'm a bartender and that's him beyond me. Like you get 10 minutes, tell me your story. And then I'm fucking out of here.
Yeah, it's a lot, but I do love it. I mean, people have breakthroughs in the, like, you know, and it is maintenance. Like they have a better week after that happens.
Mm. Yeah. I think that's why people go get massages, to be honest. Mm-hmm.
Do you have a knife massages. In your boot, Britt? Do you have a knife in your boot?
I'm protected. Let's say that.
Yeah, okay.
For legal reasons. no one needs to know my secret, but yeah, you're not getting out of there alive if something happens.
I like how like ninjas drop from the ceiling. You didn't see them, they were there the whole time.
Scary business. So you also do performance art and things of that nature. What was the last performance art show that you did?
The last performance art show, I mean, there was a performance art open mic that used to happen at Natsuo, which I miss so dearly. And I was the host of the last one that they did, or maybe it wasn't the last one before the pandemic, but it was, you know, close to before the pandemic. And the performance was, I was hosting, and in between everybody's sets, I went up and I told like a fairy tale version of the most abusive relationship I've ever had in my life. But I was like doing it like a children's story time with a book. And the book was a like clinical psychology diagnostic textbook. So the story that I was reading wasn't really coming off the pages. I was like turning the pages of the psychology book, and it was funny, but it was also pretty sad.
Yeah. That does sound heartbreaking. I went to that open mic a couple of times, and it was weird because I would go there dressed the way that I usually do, the way 40-year-old men do. And but I'd be there like thinking that I'm still like a young artist type, like I still got my notebook, I'm still writing my poetry, I'm still working on my novel, still got some screenplays in the works, you know, that kind of stuff. Like I'm still a relevant artist, man. But I would go there, and every single person that I would talk to, like eventually the conversation would worm its way back around to, are you lost? What are you doing here?
Yeah. We love it when the normies come in, but we are concerned for their safety.
What's so sad that it's like, it's just age that makes us not look like we belong there. Cause you and I were so fucking weird when we were young. It's like, no, you don't understand. I'm still in there. I just fucking, my body's different now. I'm older.
It's not age. It's definitely clothes, because there are plenty of people in the art scene to this day from, you know, 30 to 70 that are hip to the scene. Some of them, you know, they're not a normie just because they come around a lot, but they still dress like that. And then the other ones have like wackadoo hairstyles, or they have like a weird thing they do with their fashion, or they're wearing a leather, you know, harness instead of a regular outfit. Yeah. Like there's ways to make it happen. Like if you want people to know, like we can work on your style and make it happen.
I think
there's a lot of safety in that.
I think that's the thing when we get older, it's like, you know, I don't have to put it out there for everybody anymore. Some things can just be mine. Yeah,
exactly.
I think I mentally changed the target. Like I no longer want to be, you know, like vital young man. Like in my head, I'm just like, okay, we're going out. We're beloved uncle today. We're going to go be beloved uncle.
Yeah, I have to be mom so many hours of my day. I can't dress like I'm going to numbers every day anymore. I just can't.
Oh my God. Talk about being emotionally available to someone. Fuck all that.
I mean,
I thought that I wanted...
Girl.
I thought I wanted to be a mom. I was like my greatest calling in life. And then over quarantine, I was a nanny for like 4 months, live-in nanny. I was living in the house with those children. I was like, never mind. I don't need to procreate. There doesn't need to be another one of me for sure. And I'm definitely not taking care of a kid. Y'all can suck my dick. Like I'm not procreating.
I thought you just meant like walking into numbers. Like, no, I'm not emotionally available enough to walk into numbers.
I mean, honestly, sometimes like on Kinky Tuesdays, there's only like a few women there, and that's the vibe. I'm like, I'm not emotionally available for this because I'm gonna get hit on all fucking night. I'm just gonna leave.
Yeah,
I get that. Yeah, having a kid, like I don't think I ended up feeling like myself again until he was like 3.5 years old, because it's there's such a succubus. And then like, you know, when you're married, they're not the only person that needs you. And I mean, you're just like, what if I throw myself off a building? I can't do this anymore. It's so fucking hard.
I can't believe that anybody does. I can't believe anybody does it.
So there's a weird thing that happens.
It blows my mind. It's so hard.
It's why I waited so long to have kids, because I felt that way for so long. And then, you know, when it just happens, you just have to jump in to the deep end, and then you find this weird balance. But it's not easy. It's really, really hard. And then you have to find that balance. You have to find ways to stay yourself for your fucking sanity.
But it takes I imagine there are some like hormones in there that make it easier or something the actual mom.
Yeah, there's this weird biological thing that happens, because at the same time that you're feeling like you want to die, you love this person on a level that's bullshit. Like you're like, oh, so I'm just going to fucking worry about your life and your safety for the rest of my life to a level that gives me anxiety. I thought I had anxiety before I had a kid. Shit. Like it's a lot. And you know, some women are built for it. Some women are ready to do it at 19 and they do it and they do it well. I'm not that woman. I'm working on it.
God, I wish I was that man. Do you know what I mean? Like I spend a lot of time, like I just have myself to worry about. And every now and again, like things get to like the emergency level, we're just like, well, isn't that enough? Like, can't you just go save your own life? Like, for God's sake.
Yeah, myself is actually a lot.
Yeah. That's the thing about kids is it does take that pressure off. Like, you have for the first time in your life, you're like, oh, I'm not first anymore. And it's kind of a relief where you're like, oh, that's fucking great. I can just let that fucking go now. And it's really kind of nice sometimes.
I could see that, but I also think that you got to get to the point where, like, they always say it, like, you can't take care of anybody else until you learn to take care of yourself. Yep. And that's probably nobody's ever going to look at you and go, I want to have a family with you until you've got all that resolved.
Until you have a bed frame. Although I know, here's the deal. If I find the right commune and someone knocks me up, okay. And let's do this. That's fine. But I think a commune would have to help me.
Man, you don't understand the phrase, it takes a village until you have a goddamn kid. Because you're just you're screaming for help. You're like, I cannot do this alone. We're not meant to. Evolution, I mean, biologically, we're not meant to. And the structure that we have in society now is we have to. And it's why women are losing their fucking minds. Like, it's not, we're not supposed to be doing this by ourselves.
Oh, I think that's 100% true. Because there's just no safe place to raise a family anymore. Like everybody is too scary.
Mm-hmm. It's like too much work for one person. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And how are you ever going to relax? Like I think about like I grew up
in separate houses.
That was my favorite line. I used to give a friend of mine shit that we worked together. I'm like, how did you do this? How do you live with yourself? And he'd look at me and go, I live in separate rooms. Like that's perfect. Anyway. Hey, I think about where I grew up. It was very, very rural and very, very safe. And my mom and dad had four kids and they would just let us just run because there was nothing like other than scrape knees and cut some barbed wire. So like, there was no stranger danger or anything like that. I look around, I live in a pretty nice neighborhood and I'm still just like, I couldn't imagine like letting a 7-year-old just run around the streets. You know, we got a little corner store just 4 blocks away. There's no way that I would let an 8 or 9-year-old just like, oh, I'm just gonna go down there and get a candy bar.
It's a different world, man. I was little. We were poor. I grew up like near Greens Point. I lived in a trailer and then I lived in an apartment near Greens Point and I was outside all day. Didn't know where I was. Like, fucking tough. I was fucking tough and ghetto. But yeah, I mean, I wouldn't do that now with my kid. I don't really even let him fucking go to the bus stop by himself and it's in front of my house. Like,
it's real fear.
We went crazy on this. Okay, let's loop it back to whatever the fuck we're talking about.
Well, here, I'll connect it. Are you ready? Are you ready for the connective tissue? So I'm polyamorous, okay? One of the reasons I'm polyamorous is because I think that I want to live my life with a bunch of people that I love and maybe fuck, who's to say? Which is a great time to plug my podcast, Poly Want a Podcast, which I haven't published an episode of in like a year and a half. They're still up there if you want to learn more. There's some good 101 episodes. For me, like having a community of people, you know, my family situation wasn't amazing. But you know, having chosen family through the polyamorous community has been really beneficial for me. And like being in relationships, excuse me, with people that have kids and like kind of helping them with their kids in a really impactful way without having to like have an infant crying in my house for 24 hours a day. That sounds amazing.
Mm-hmm. You want to come over?
You know I do. I play hella video games. Like, I'm down.
We were talking about it. Like, she's a gamer. That's all my autistic son wants to do. Like, they get hyper focused on one thing, and this one can only take so much. Where I'm like, Britt, you're in. Like, get in there.
I don't have the emotional capacity for polyamory. I just know I don't. Obviously, lifestyles aren't for everybody, but I marvel at it. Like a good friend of mine is part of a throuple right now. And like, she'll come to me with complaints or just talking about her relationship the way good friends do. And I'm just like, I don't know what to tell you. Like, I have never been, I'm out of my depth. I don't know what you're doing. I know I couldn't do it. There's no way.
Hey, at least like, you know, you don't know.
And that's part of the reason why I stay the hell away from it. But like there must be like, I mean, there's power dynamics in every relationship, right? Like I have another friend who has, I don't even know what to call it or how, but they basically have an arrangement where they're married and they're very committed to each other, but they're also allowed to date other people with the other person's approval. Like they can't, they have to, you know, they go, okay, I'm going to go out with this person. Here's who they are. Here's what I know about them. And they go through, like, it would torture me. Like if I was in a relationship with somebody and they were having their date night and I was alone or I had to find something to occupy my time while I know that that's going on, it would drive me fucking insane. How do you deal with that?
I don't know why I am just so lucky to not care that much. I mean, I definitely do get jealous. I'm not like above jealousy at all. Like when my boyfriend's on a date, I'm like, you know, definitely a little anxious. Like, what if this is the love of his life and he's going to leave me and whatever. But I also believe that I want him to be as happy as he can. And if that's going to be with someone else, then that's how it's going to be. We also don't have any assets together. We don't have children. There's nothing, you know, that him staying in a relationship with me would like ruin my life or anything. So,
right.
I think that there, I was lucky to get into polyamory at young enough age when I wasn't in a couple. I was just by myself and I discovered polyamory and I was like, oh, well, I only want this kind of relationship. And so it was only through community education that I was able to sort of get over that feeling that I own someone or that they like belong to me. But I also think I'm just kind of naturally polyamorous at heart. You know, like I don't have those feelings of, you know, like it's betrayal for someone to cheat on me. You know what I mean? Like it's even in my relationships right. When I was monogamous, if someone cheated on me, I was like, okay, well, there's obviously an emotional reason that you did that. And let's investigate that. You know, it's not like, you know, going to ruin my life or anything.
I think it's admirable because it's a big drop of ego. We talk about ego a lot in therapy and, you know, just becoming a whole person. And it's such a wall for so many people. And it's dropping that ego to where you can realize that, you know, you can still love someone and let go of that jealousy if it's not just, they're just obsessed with you. You know, that's ego. Mm. I just want you to love me, you know, and you gotta let that go.
That's what I'd be like. I also think like, I think my ego would be, cause I think it would start to feel like they're picking and choosing the parts of me that they want. Do you know what I mean? Like, okay. You like the way that I make the ham sandwiches, but, but you don't want to spend the night with me. You know what I mean? Like I don't quite know how to boil it down, but I think if I was in a polyamorous relationship, even if I was, you know, enjoying several other people, I would still feel like the person that I was, cause I would naturally form a stronger bond with one person. I would worry that that person was only like taking the good qualities that I have or like not accepting the whole thing. And that would make me feel broken and empty in a weird way. I'm very curious about it, Britt. I don't mean to be, I'm asking questions. I hope it doesn't sound judgmental, but I'm honestly curious about it because it just doesn't make emotional sense to me.
Well, yeah, people that are monogamous normally have a pretty good idea of whether or not they would be able to make polyamory happen for themselves. I've seen people kind of go back and forth, you know, like they try polyamory, they don't like it, they go back to monogamy. And then there are also people that are in polyamorous relationships that, you know, they're committed to it because it's what they believe in. And so if something like that were to come up for them, they would see that more as like something to work on in themselves rather than something to like hold their partner, you know, responsible for. Like, but at the same time, like it's hard to put yourself in those shoes of someone who's polyamorous when you're monogamous, because like, it doesn't make sense, you know, like,
yeah. It doesn't and, like, obviously it's exciting, you know, from a male perspective. It's like, you mean we get to go and have sex as much sex as we want? That sounds terrific. And you're like, no, live in the real world. That's not, not how that works. Clearly.
Yeah. My sweet boyfriend. Oh, go ahead.
Oh, sorry. Let me read this real quick just to get it out of the way, because I knew that we were going to get here. And I don't know why. I don't know if I manifested this to me, but for, and I don't even listen to Joni Mitchell. This quote by Joni Mitchell came up on monogamy, and I read the whole thing, and I'm not going to read the whole thing now. You can find it if you just Google it, but I highlighted two things. So this was her, like, you know, if you had like a debate, like polyamory here and monogamy here, and like, I think both have very, very valid points, but hers was very interesting to me. And one thing I really disagree with, one of the pull quotes she said is, if you want endless repetition, see a lot of different people. If you want infinite variety, stay with one. And I was like, say what? Someone who's been with someone for 16 years, I'm like, no offense, Corbin, but like, I think he would look at me and be like, no, that's not true. But the next quote that I thought was so interesting, and she said, what happens when you date is you run all your best moves and tell all your best stories. And in a way, that routine is a method for falling in love with yourself over and over, which I was like, oh, I see that. And, you know, it doesn't have to be just about dating. This is meeting a new friend, starting a new job, going to a new city. You give the best version of yourself and you put yourself on display. And that really is like falling in love with the best parts of yourself over and over again, which I found pretty interesting. But I think I disagree with her on the like endless repetition, see a lot of different people, because I don't find that true at all.
No, that is fascinating that you just like, basically you get your patter down, like you get your sales pitch totally fine tuned, you know, the way a stand-up gets their whole act done. Like, okay, well, yep. what have you really accomplished there?
Yeah.
And it's made me think of George Clooney in Burn After Reading. Do you ever see that movie?
Yeah.
He's running around on dating apps, cheating on his wife. And there's like this montage scene where he's just out with several women doing the same patter over and over and over again. And he's just absolutely nailing it. But I meant I bet polyamory must be on a different level than that. I mean, that's just dating new people. That's one-to-one dating. But in polyamory, like you have to adjust for the people that you're not attracted to, because like presumably not everybody who's polyamorous is also bisexual, right? So like if I were in, it's called a polycule, right? You guys have such cute vocabulary. So if I was in a polycule, I would somehow have to put aside the part of my brain that is just naturally like this dude is a sexual rival. I don't know that I could do that. Like, I don't know that I could do that. I don't know that if I could be that intimate with another guy where I could admit, just like, okay, well, there's something that she wants from you that she can't get from me, and that's okay somehow. I just it's beyond me.
I love the term sexual rival though, because that sounds so fucking dramatic. But yeah, there is like this kind of way that it's about understanding that it's not necessarily that someone is not able to provide something, it's that many people provides different things, you know? So like, my boyfriend's great. There's also this other guy. It doesn't mean that my boyfriend's like not good in bed if I'm fucking this other guy. It's just like a part of both of those relationships, and it's different kinds of sex, you know?
Yeah. It's part of your relationship obligation to, I don't know how to put it, satisfy the mother. Right. But I don't mean to get too into the nuts and bolts or into the weeds. And again, like, I'm not, so I don't know, but does the whole polycule ever get together around the dinner table? Again, non-sex division is what I mean.
You guys need to go to dinner and just help Ben out for this.
I'm really curious about it. Like, I can't. So I don't know how big these things get or how big, but let's say that you've got a girlfriend and two boyfriends, and your two boyfriends have another girlfriend. Now, does that mean that you're obligated to be intimate with their girlfriends? I mean, obviously it's going to be like a...
Yeah, we all have to fight to the death to see who gets to keep
the alpha
male.
I warned you this is going to be some ignorant questions.
No, I love it. And people are curious about it. And I appreciate that, because a lot of the things that you see about polyamory or hear about aren't necessarily authentic to what polyamory actually is, which is kind of a choose your own adventure. Like, I'm not obligated to go to that dinner. If everyone in the polycule is going and I don't want to go, like, I don't have to go. But I have been in polycules before where, yeah, like we all get together for Christmas or something. Or there's also something called kitchen table poly. And kitchen table poly is where you have such a tight knit polycule that you do sit down at the kitchen table together. But even the definition of that implies that there is an opposite, which is where, you know, the polycule is kind of just strewn about your life and you don't, you know, necessarily have to or ever get to, you know, interact with your, you know, extended metamors or your metamor or stuff like that. It really just depends on what you metamor. Want.
Yeah, that's
everybody's just talking about what they want to do.
Vocabulary world.
And if this works for me and
society in general, live in such a black and white world, they want to see like the rules posted like at the swimming pool. This is what polyamorous people be. And like, that's not what it is. We don't live in a black and white world. Every single polyamorous relationship lives in the gray and they have their own rules. We're individual people. Like, stop trying to make sense of everything in one blanket statement. I don't think it works that way.
I think that's what fascinates me though. It's just like, I can't live in that much gray. Like, I could not live in the fog, and I'm fascinated by people who can make it work for themselves. Like, it just, there's no, cause like I say, Britt and I are friends. I've got two other friends who are doing something very similar. And I just like throw up my hands. Like, I don't fucking know. Like, I just don't understand how that works.
Britt, correct me if I'm wrong, but I'm assuming that anyone that can be in a healthy polyamorous relationship are people that have done a lot of like important work on themselves and maybe have worked out their ego and understand themselves on a level that maybe other people don't.
I mean, ideally people are at that point once they start, but generally, you know, it takes some work to get there. But I do think that there is something interesting about polyamorous people that they are very self-reflective and have like a very conscious way of entering relationships. The thing with monogamy is they're, even though there's not like rules posted at the pool, like there are kind of rules, you know, people know, like this is how our relationship's going to go. If we start dating, we're going to become exclusive. We're going to do this. We're going to do that. Right. And in polyamory, because you don't have that, you have to be communicating more and you have to ask yourself what you want more. Mm-hmm. And because you're having to do those things in order to engage in those kinds of relationships at all, you generally become a little more self-aware and you become better at communicating and you meet different people that like different things. And then you start to add that to maybe what you want for your future. So I think it is confusing because it is confusing. Like, yeah, it is, it's just a way of living life. Mm. Yeah. That is not reliant on the kind of monogamous, like nuclear family structure that we are so accustomed to like seeing and being a part of.
Well, it's what you've been spoon fed since you were born, unless you grew up in a polyamorous relationship, like parents, you know? I mean, so it's relearning so much.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I don't think it would make me better at communicating. I think it would make me better at being bitter and withholding.
Well,
you
there
seem
are
to be spending a lot
those.
Of time in the bathroom, Ben. Did we do it? I don't think that UMI's love affair was about all of the things that we talked about, but I do think that we talked about UMI's love affair.
Yeah, definitely check her out. She is a creative genius. There are so many amazing videos of her on YouTube. She's a really talented musician, and you can look her up. I love that song because it's catchy. But she also has a lot of other amazing music.
Yeah. Apparently she has like a song that was like a bigger hit. It's called Remember Me or something like that. That was huge.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I love that song too. It's really good.
All right. Before we run out of time, let's watch together 6 Degrees of Tommy Stinson with Jeremy Essig and see how he connects Tommy Stinson to UMI. So
I really hope this is his biggest challenge yet.
So he recorded this months ago when we were originally going to do this, so it's a little dated, but let's see.
Okay.
Hey friends, welcome to the I Feel Old edition of 6 Degrees, where this week Who Am I? An RSI I've never heard of before Diane a few weeks ago. So, to lead into Stanhope's theory, I 100% had to start Googling to start this one. From that research, I found out that UMI's Love Language album features bass from Teo Halam. Who's Teo Halam? Well, to paraphrase Fletch, they're UMI's bassist. And who is UMI? The artist that features bass from Teo Halam. As I dug deeper, I found that Huam also played keyboards on Miley Cyrus's Plastic Hearts album. And now, my friends, we are back in my wheelhouse. And that album is packed full of lessons, including the great Joan Jett, who duets with Cyrus on the song Bad Karma. No stranger to guests herself, Jett's 1991 song Backlash, the duet with Replacements frontman Paul Westerberg, who formed that band with a preteen Tommy Stinson. So, Fletch, the Hannah Montana, Light of Days, Patty Raznick to Tommy Stinson.
He can do hysterical. It with anyone.
Good job, Jeremy. That was great.
Nice work, Jeremy.
All right, Britt, I don't know if you've had time to think about this, but do you have a guilty pleasure song?
Yeah, my guilty pleasure song, right? Here's the deal. I don't feel like guilty, you know what I mean? But when I'm listening to it, I definitely am like, it's not when someone's in the car with me, you know what I mean? Like, it's when I'm alone.
Yeah, exactly.
That's our definition. You roll up the windows.
Okay, cool. It's called Hot Girl Bummer. Okay. And it's by a musician named Black Bear.
Okay.
All one word. The song is horribly embarrassing. It's so bad. One of the lines in it is actually college dropout music. And that's kind of how it feels to listen to it. Like, it's definitely college dropout music. It's like something that I would listen to when I was living in a trailer in Tomball. You know what I mean? But it just, he's a newer artist. Like, he's not from that era, but he just brings me back to that time.
That's awesome. I can't wait to hear it.
I'm through. This that hot girl bummer anthem. Turn it up and throw a tantrum. Fuck you.
That does sound perfect. Hey, thanks for doing this with us. Like, I hope you don't feel like I was like putting your feet to the fire or torturing you in any way. Like, I'm just honestly curious about your lifestyle because it's so foreign from mine.
I love talking about myself. I love explaining shit. Like, it was fine. It's perfect. I've definitely been in interviews where the vibe was not cool. But here it was cool. No feet to the fire.
All right, before we let you go, promote yourself, like all your Instagrams, where people can find and see and hear more of you.
I do have a lot of Instagrams. You can find me at FullaBritt, which is FullaBritt. And then I also have a website, BrittVasicek.com. And from my website, you can get to all of the things that I do if you just click around enough, including some of the art that I make. I do tarot readings, like card readings. I do spell work for people. And you can find me on Twitter at FullaBritt as well. I have a show that just started last month, called Hot Slut Speakeasy, and it's coming back again. It's going to be a monthly for a 5-month run at Midtown Bar and Grill upstairs. And it's a kinky variety show. So the next one is on January 21st. So if you want to go get kinky and learn a little bit about polyamory and kink, we're going to be doing it upstairs with some comedy and some music. And the tickets for that go on sale. That's my sister's
birthday. Diane, do you want to go?
It's whose birthday?
That's my sister's birthday. Do you want to go?
Sure. Of course.
Yay. Oh my God. That'll be so fun.
No, there's nothing my sister would hate more than that.
Even funner.
Yes. And then, I took his parents to their first drag show. So we're going to pull your sister to a hot slut show.
We're just going to taint the whole family.
We are.
And then the next thing that I'm on is I'm doing a storytelling show at Rudyard's on December 16th called Rideshare Confessionals. So I'm going to be telling a story, probably a scary kinky one, on December 16th. So if you want tickets for that, it's the Riot HTX.
Awesome.
Excellent. The Riot. Those are all my things. Good show. Yay. Thank you so much for coming on and talking with us. I really appreciate it.
Thank you. I had so much fun. Y'all are amazing. I want to come back and just hang out.
Sure. Let's hang out.
We'll be at your shows. Thank you very much, Britt. Really appreciate it. We'll see you very soon.
Bye.
Thank you. Cheers. Well, what do you think?
That was great. It was a good time. I love getting wine drunk at night instead of in the morning.
This is a hell of a lot better. I feel much, much healthier about this. Yes. I'm going to finish this glass of wine. I'm going to smoke a little marijuana and go to bed.
maybe I'll do the same and then put my child to bed. I got to read him some Dr. Seuss before.
Oh, yeah, do that before you smoke some pot.
Hold on, hold on. Next week, we have to talk about next week. We have our December Patreon and Steve Ryan, we drew his name, and he hasn't chosen a song yet. So it's a surprise.
In his defense, he hasn't chosen a song yet because I haven't called him yet. I'm going to call him tomorrow.
So surprise. And hey, that'll be our last episode for 2 weeks. We're going to take a 2-week break during Christmas because you know what? Everybody needs a fucking break for Christmas. And then we'll be back after that. But yeah, one more episode before the break.
Perfect. Thank you. This was fun. And
One, two, three. Rock the Cash Bar is produced by Diane Gallagher. Music by Chuck Savage and Eddie Hawkins. Special thank you to Jeremy Essig for 6 Degrees of Tommy Stinson and to Sara Wessling for the Guilty Pleasures of Vocals. Our website is rockthecashbarpodcast.com, and there you can find links to our Spotify playlist and to our Patreon. Thank you for tuning in, and we will see you next week.